All right, come on, let's get this over with. I got to get home to watch Dancing with the Stars. Nick Lachey is doing the jitterbug. He's good. Have you ever seen him?
No, no.
You got your guards up.
No, no.
You want to fight?
He's kidding, right, champ?
Don't be so scared. You should learn to control your fears. Take me, for instance. I'm afraid of the dark, but you'd never know it because I have mental discipline. You know what I'm saying? I don't even use a nightlight no more.
Okay,
okay. Whoa, whoa. Oh, fine. What's up? What's up? What's up? No pride or glory for the loser. There's blood and broken teeth all over the place. And the last thing you'll hear is the cry of cougar. Lock your doors, get off the streets. I'm on the prowl, I'm telling you, I'm on the hunt now. And welcome to this week's episode of the Movie Dump Podcast. I'm Ben.
I'm Scott.
I'm drunk.
We did bring some more beer to go along with this lovely review of the Broken Lizard film, The Slammin Salmon, starring all the guys from Broken Lizard and Michael Clarke Duncan.
Yep.
With God cameos right. By
these people.
Ben, we don't have subtitles engaged on this episode.
Well, then fuck.
All right.
Let's move on. So, Scott, what beer did you bring today? What is this?
It's just something I randomly picked out. We were over at, where was that place at?
The World of Beer.
World of Beer, that's right.
Beer.
How could I be so non-traveled and stuff? But anyway, yeah, I don't know why I was going with that. Anyway, I got, it's an Ovila Quad, which was, it's done in collaboration with the Abbey of New Clairvaux.
So, like, monks made this?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, and actually, cool. part of the money that was made off this beer goes to help them build some new monastery or something like that.
That's pretty cool.
Or goes into a slush fund. I don't really know. You know, it's monks. You know, you
weekend
never know.
Bender in Vegas.
Yeah, yeah. With the tax monks. Exempt from the government. I'm just saying. You know, whatever.
That's pretty cool. That's pretty
yeah,
cool.
Yeah.
What did you bring, Nick?
I stopped by my favorite brewery, Breckenridge, one of my favorite breweries, and this week I am going to have an agave wheat from Breckenridge Brewery.
Oh.
Got a cool. Nice little label.
But
little
agave one. Goes in tequila and nothing else.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. This is dividing by zero shit right here.
So,
what did you get, Ben?
I actually found a little Samuel Adams beer called Griffin's Bow.
You're fucked.
Is that Gryffindor?
Is it sad that that's kind of one of the things that deterred me into getting
it? The like, hat told me to
it's like, Gryffindor! Oh, no, Griffin Bow. Good enough.
It's close, it's close.
I was like, I'm going to be tasting butterbeer! Oh, yeah! No, but this should be pretty good. It's a barley wine ale.
That'd be pretty good. I haven't actually had a barley wine.
It's a pretty big bottle, 10% alcohol by volume. So
oh, geez, I don't even know what this one is.
That should feel pretty good by the end of this podcast.
Yep. I have a six pack.
Yeah, you went for like the smallest bottle. And we all got like, these
beat
big
you 10.4.
Well, those 4 points right there.
Yep, yep.
What, that yours is 10.4% alcohol?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, mine's 10% alcohol.
Fuck. Yeah. And mine's like 4%.
Yeah, these are
pretty hefty.
These are like wine bottle sizes.
I'm going to have to carry the podcast. I'm going to be at least drunk of us all.
Well, you actually have more beer than us, so you may actually...
Well, that might even out.
Never know.
We'll start bringing in our alter egos, like one of the characters in
Chad
this
and McGuire.
So let's pop these open really fast. Right, let's get this going.
Mine's actually a cork, which is
okay.
Sorta,
you got the cork this week.
I'm waiting for it to explode or something off the top of here.
I need a bottle opener. This isn't twist top.
No.
Here we go, popping agave Breckenridge.
Whoa!
Jesus Christ,
that
man.
Is with authority, man.
Whoa.
I'm glad I had my hand on the
that
top of that.
That sounded painful.
That could have taken out everything.
Wow, and here goes my pathetic little...
Oh, shit!
Man, that's sort of like what happened to me last time.
We have issues with popping beer.
Man.
I didn't do that. Why the fuck did I do that?
I didn't either. I was afraid it was going to explode all over the place.
Yeah.
I can smell the cork.
All right, ready?
That's some good stuff
out
there. Yep.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Oh, wow.
Mine's very tasty.
That's really good.
This is complex.
Scott has the most scientific beer.
Oh, it really is. It's a smorgasbord of flavor.
Smorgasbord.
All right, rotate. Let me try.
Scroll change down. Beers!
Oh. I'll trade you, Ben. There you go. All right, I'll try this.
Whoa. Whoa. Whoa.
Ooh.
Auville la Quad. Wow.
Agave wheat is pretty damn good.
Yeah, the agave wheat's good. I like this Auville Quad.
Like I said, it's complex.
It doesn't have a harsh taste. It kind of goes down really soft and nice.
There this Auville Quad.
It's like silk down your throat.
Auville Quad, it reminds me of that one meal candy from, you know, Willy Wonka, where you eat it and then you taste like six different meals.
Oh, the gum where it's like, oh, it's Thanksgiving.
It's chocolatey, it's coffee, it's hoppy. It's pretty nice.
Mmm. Not bad.
That's really good.
You know, after drinking that and the other two really powerful beers, I really can't taste the wheat very well.
Nick's beer is really weak compared to the rest of
the
world.
The winning round, I think, goes to Auville Quad.
Yeah, Auville Quad, I think, out of the three of these is good with Griffin's Bow in a close second.
And I can't judge that. I mean, I'm sure it's delicious. I just can't taste it. So
was good. I can't taste it anymore after drinking.
Yeah, this Auville Quad is definitely
that's gonna
one of
fuck you up.
This
about
is
an
like
hour.
This is like a meal almost.
It's thick, kind of like a stout, but it's not.
It's thick like a steak,
thick like my
not
and
flaky like a salmon.
And this the Griffin's Bow is kind of a little hoppy.
Ben, I was trying to segue back into the movie.
Oh, sorry.
I said, but it's flaky like a salmon.
So yeah, we watched the movie.
Yeah, the movie. What?
We watched.
Did we already say what we watched?
Yeah.
It is in the title of the podcast, damn it.
Yeah, it was Broken Lizards, Slammin Salmon. Broken Lizards, the guys that brought you Super Troopers,
also,
Club Dread, Beer Fest, all those.
The guys that brought you this movie that you have never heard of.
Yeah, this is a movie that kind of flew under the radar.
Way under the radar. There was no
advertising for this. It just happened.
It was very, very small advertising, very small theater release. And then it just came out on DVD and Blu-ray, but I just saw it because, you know, I'm a pretty big Super Troopers fan, and Beer Fest was good. Club Dread, it's probably the weaker out of all of theirs, but it still is kind of funny.
I can't say I've actually seen Club Dread. It was just never one of those movies that actually.
It's interesting. Give it a watch. It's interesting.
I got nothing really to do the rest of the weekend.
Yeah, but. This is definitely one that not a lot of people knew about, and it has the late great Michael Clarke Duncan in it, and I think one of his better roles, because a lot of times he's doing dramatic roles, and this is
this
more
is
of
just
a,
pure out crazy.
This showcased his comedic side, which I thought was really good.
Really, he was the funniest out of everyone in it.
Oh yeah, which is it's kind of hard. I mean, you have a comedy troupe like Broken Lizard guys who. To me, are like a modern day like Marx Brothers or an American version of Monty Python. Like they're the only comedy troupe right now that's actually making films, and staying busy and all that, in the limelight. So, it's really something to say that Michael Clarke Duncan was the funniest out of this movie.
Yeah, because when you can like hold your own with those guys, you know, sort of, you know, blend in with their style and still maintain your own sort of style, that says something right
And
there.
He's not a comedian. He's right. He's just a damn good actor and one that we are all going to miss. But enough about that. Let's go into
this. What do
you
mean
movie.
We're going to miss him?
He's dead.
What? What you doing to him?
Oh, you've been just waiting for the iPhone 5 so long. you haven't been paying attention to anything else that's happened this past month.
Look, I got an extra inch of screen.
That could have gotten dirty real fast right there. Look, I got an extra inch of screen.
All right, so Scott, why don't you read the synopsis of this film and then we'll get into it.
Okay, I don't know if you're ready for this, though. It's a doozy.
I'm ready.
You ready? I'm not sure you're ready.
Just fucking read it!
Okay. The owner of a Miami restaurant indebted to the mob institutes a contest to see what waiter can earn the most money in one night.
God, I need you to talk like that. for the rest of your life.
the rest of my life.
That, wait. Close your eyes. I want to see.
Close my eyes.
I'm going to close my eyes. Nick, close your eyes. All right. Who does it sound like more? Right. Go ahead.
Scott. Read it again.
Just say anything.
Ben's a douche. He smells like rancid cheese and looks like a potato. Nick, however, is a strapping young man from the wrong side of town. He may look tough on the outside, but he's got a heart of gold.
He sounds more like Morgan Freeman than Michael Clarke Duncan.
I think he belongs in the Warriors. That's all. He belongs in the Warriors with that voice. That's it.
Just... You need to be like narrating prison movies.
Or penguin movies. Or...
You never know what it's going to be like for real until those bars slam home. Wow. That's it. I'm just doing the rest of the podcast like that. So Scott, how was your day? Oh, it's pretty good. I woke up, had myself a balanced nutritional breakfast, and came right on over to review a movie.
See, beforehand, when Scott talks, it's just like, shut up, Scott. When Scott talks like that, you're like, smooth, keep talking.
You're like, smooth talking.
I want to listen.
It's like everything he says is interesting now.
Yeah, it is. It's very interesting.
It's all about adjectives, man. It's all about adjectives.
That's good.
So this movie, it just takes place in the Slammin Salmon restaurant, which is down in Miami. It's more of like a high-class pricier restaurant.
Yeah, it's like a higher class steak.
It's steakhouse,
but with seafood.
Yeah, it's like a seafood steakhouse type of.
It's the place that you go and think the food is going to be really, really good, and then you get there and you realize you're paying $80 for like tuna, and you're like,
out of a can.
Why am I? And you just flat out lie and go like, oh, that was magnificent. That was great food, but it really wasn't that good at all. Yeah. It's just kind of meh.
Yeah,
it was presented nicely.
It's a lot of people have said that this is a higher. This is like Waiting, but for a higher class restaurant.
Yeah,
the movie Waiting.
I think it's
in that same vein. But honestly, you do a movie about restaurants,
It's always going to be compared to Waiting
because Waiting was kind of one of those ones that just sticks out. I'm not going to say it's the first movie that's based off of restaurant staff, but I don't know if it is or not.
It was the catalyst that embedded itself into a movie genre, and is the one thing you compare all Waiting sort of restaurants to. Crap.
Shut up, Morgan Freeman.
You lost your substance there halfway through, I think. Not even.
I ran out of words that made me were big and sounded sexy, so yeah. I was like,
"It's
oh,
almost
stuff.
Like it's almost like Ron Burgundy. You need some like jazz flute playing behind you as you talk like that." But it's kind of like if somebody made a movie about a convenience store, it'd be compared to Clerks.
Yeah, you know? Exactly.
That's one of those things.
Yeah, it's
or about a mystical chocolate factory. They compare it to The Sixth Sense.
So yeah, a lot of people make that comparison, and I don't know if that deters people, and they're like, oh, Broken Lizard's, you know, jumping on the Waiting bandwagon and just trying to like. Play off of their movie, and they're just making a cheap copy.
I can't really say that.
Besides it taking place in a restaurant, that's as far as the comparison.
Still has in common.
Plus, you know, it's like this movie was made far enough away from the Waiting that it's sort of hard to make that comparison there of just ripping something off.
Yeah. And I mean, after a while,
I'm sure they borrowed stuff from it. I mean, because it's sort of hard. There's only so many stereotypes.
I don't know if they borrowed it from them because all the guys that are in the Broken Lizard, the comedy troupe, have worked somewhere in the restaurant business before. So they were pulling stuff like that actually happened to them or people that they've known and using them to make the characters for what they used in this film. But
I thought all the characters were kind of bland.
Yeah, the characters were kind of bland. They could have been fleshed out a little bit more. But that being said, they all did their own, their part. There were some parts there's some parts in the story that they kind of like brought in. They were like, "Oh, I don't know why that's there," but it didn't deter it from it being a good movie.
Right.
And it also didn't make it a good movie.
True.
It was just kind of blah there.
Yeah.
Are you trying to do the voice too?
No.
No, I'm not trying to do the voice. I don't know what you're talking about.
The film pretty much took place only at the restaurant. So
No outside anything.
Yeah, there was no exterior shots. Everything.
Oh, that's a lie. There was a couple exterior shots.
Yeah, there was one, but there was one exterior shot. But everything was around the was at the restaurant except for one shot, which was the
there's a hotel.
Yeah, it was the spa.
A spa hotel casino area.
With Jim Gaffigan.
Yeah, with Jim Gaffigan playing the
funny cameo.
Playing the guy. Actually, you just want to play that soundbite?
Might as well.
Okay. I just played this soundbite just because, you know, we want to throw
drink beer. Bites.
Good evening, Persuasion Spa and Casino Resort. I'm Stanley Bellin. How may I persuade you?
Hey, Stanley, it's Rich Parente calling on behalf of Cleon Salmon. Yeah, the champ would like to book his regular suite.
Oh, I'm afraid the suite is not available for Mr. Salmon.
what do you mean? Why not?
Because last time Mr. Salmon's pet kangaroo defecated in our kitchen.
Oh, well, that kangaroo was no longer with us. The champ actually killed him during a sparring session.
I'm so sorry to hear that. Unfortunately, I will have to politely say no.
Is that Stanley? Let me talk to him.
Don't tell him it's me. Just...
Yes, champ, it's Stanley Bellin.
Tell him I said I want the Emperor's suite or I'm gonna shove his ass up his ass.
Of course Mr. Salmon can stay in the Emperor's suite. I was merely joking.
Tell him to make the reservation under King Kamehameha.
All right, Kamehameha. How many M's?
And it better be free or I'm gonna knock Stanley into Bolivian.
Yeah, he said that he was hoping it would be free or he was gonna knock you into Bolivian. But I think he means Oblivion.
Whatever, motherfucker!
It'll be free. It'll be free.
That was kind of an interesting scene. Let's back up because you're probably listening to that going, okay, that's nice. What does that have to do with anything? So let's go back to the very beginning of the film where we see it's a year before the events in the film take place. And Rich Harnett, which is played by Kevin Heffernan.
Just say the fat guy.
The fat guy, Broken Lizard.
Every comedy troupe needs fat guy.
Yep. How are you going to do fat jokes if you don't have a fat guy?
Mm-hmm. Which is weird. They didn't really do a lot of fat jokes.
It's good because, like, you know, he's usually the angry fat guy almost. So,
yeah, except in Club Dread, which he was the pacifist.
Yeah.
I'll take your word for that. I haven't seen that movie, so.
But yeah, he's working as a waiter there, and he has an issue with one of the customers, and he gets all fed up, and he's like, you know what, I'm done with this, I'm gonna quit.
Oh yeah.
And for him to quit, he has to go tell the champ, which apparently is like a big, huge fucking deal. Like, no one stands up to the champ. The champ is the big dog. He's the bully. Everyone else is underneath him. Everyone's scared of him. So that pretty much plays out through the whole entire movie. That's like, for me, that's the whole story arc of the whole film. Is it's the small guy standing up to the big guy.
Yeah, the underlying theme. And you know, Michael Clarke Duncan played the champ, obviously.
Exactly.
He's a big dude.
Uh-huh.
He's probably one of the bigger dudes I've ever seen on TV. He's huge. So he did that part very well.
Yeah, yes, he did.
He does all sorts of, you know, threats about shoving people's asses directly up their asses, shoving
every quote
using people's spines as jump ropes.
And if anything, this reminds me of
a broken rib sandwich.
If like Archie Bunker was big, powerful, and no one wanted to like stand up to him.
Yep.
Just like he would just say random shit. It's not pronounced right. It's not the right type of phrase or whatever. And he just doesn't give a shit. Like, someone would try to correct him, and he would, well.
So my first time hunting these albinos, an albino ran right past me. I got so nervous, I smacked him in the head and almost decapitated him.
It's decapitated, champ.
Whatever, motherfucker! Hmm.
So you just spew that out. And I mean.
It's pretty accurate.
Yeah. Yep. I mean, if you have a big, huge, intimidating guy yelling at you like that, you would just be like, okay, all right, sure. Sure.
Tell stories, you know, about how the last guy who quit is ended now breathing through a tube.
Yeah, yeah. Or how he killed someone in the ring. Yeah. Or he killed his pet kangaroo in a sparring match. Yeah. It's definitely setting up that this is a guy you do not want to fuck with. And no one is stand up to him. And that's why he's the way that he is. Because he's just used to, you know, a whole bunch of yes men.
Yeah.
Because everyone's afraid of him.
Oh, yeah.
So that plays out through the whole entire movie because Rich, you know, wanted to quit and then he's afraid, so he doesn't quit. He has an accident at work, which I guess led to him becoming a manager a year later.
Kind of weird how they did that.
It just it was
well, promoter sue. Yeah. You
know? It was their way of showing that this guy is, you know,
sort of a pushover.
He's a big pushover.
Not just
sort of a pushover.
Yeah, just what
and
you
then
said.
Like
yeah.
later on in the movie you find out, you know, he has a wife, three kids. You find out that his wife is actually the champ's sister. And
which that was funny
and the reason why he was okay with Rich going out with his marrying his sister was because he's such a pussy he would never cheat on her. That was his logic behind, oh yeah, I'm fine with you dating my sister because you would never fucking cheat on her because you know I would kick the crap out of you because you're such a pussy. And he actually gave him a nickname. What was the nickname?
You want to know what my nickname for him was? Cunty McTwat, because he was such a pussy. Why isn't anybody laughing?
Oh, that's a good nickname.
Yeah.
Cunty McTwat. Cunty
McTwat.
It really rolls off the tongue.
Kind of does. A lot of stuff that he said in this movie as insults just kind of rolled off the tongue.
Yeah, yeah. In a confusing sort of up your ass sort of way.
Yeah. And it's just one of those, you're not going to... What are you going to do? What are you going to do? Michael Clarke Duncan just called you Cunty McTwat. Are you going to say, no, sir, I am not Cunty McTwat? No. You will not. Because Michael Clarke Duncan
will kill you.
Or would have killed you.
He would snap your arms off like toothpicks and beat you to death with them.
Yes.
And then defecate on your corpse.
Scott, do it in the voice.
Do it.
Do it in the voice?
Yeah.
Oh, man. I don't know. He would snap your arms off like toothpicks and then beat you to death with them and then defecate on you.
No.
No, it didn't quite. Yeah, you lost it there. You went to Illinois.
To Illinois?
Yep.
Nick, try it.
Try it, Nick.
No. I'm just not going to do
it.
Come
on.
No.
Yeah, you got to accentuate your
try.
I'm not going to do it.
You got to be
able to snap. I can't do it.
You got to reach down into your diaphragm.
Get down in there.
And regurgitate some vowels.
You see, what we're going to do here is we're going to break off your arms.
Oh, now. Going to break your arms off.
I'm going to beat you. I'm going to beat you to death. With your arms.
Because you're a fucking cunt. Because
you're a fucking cunt and cunt. Make cunt of fans.
Then I'm going to stick my foot so far up your ass, you'll be like, hey, my foot is a foot and a half up your ass.
Okay, you got it back. So, you brought up an interesting point that this entire movie could have been a play.
Yeah, almost.
It
was, because since it took place in one location, it could have been easily done as a stage performance, because, I mean, sets don't really have to be moved around all that much. It could all be done right there.
I think this would have worked out better as a play, honestly.
I think so, too. I think it probably would have worked out better as a play, because, I don't know, it just had that feel. It had that feel of more of a play mentality than as a feature film.
Look, if they could make Pee Wee's Playhouse into a stage performance, they could make this into a stage performance.
But for the same reason, Pee Wee's Playhouse, pretty much took place in one location.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. It all works.
Could take place in one location. So let's start going off with some of the characters. We have a ballerina.
Yep.
Who at the beginning of this contest that they're having to raise the money, she's using her sex appeal as her way of getting all the tips, and she's skyrocketing up there.
Because why not?
Yeah,
that's what pretty waitresses do.
Exactly.
Every guy in the world has fallen victim to this at least once.
Yeah,
like a Hooters, you're like, here's all my money, just take it.
Even though she's wearing like a full length. A long sleeve shirt with a tie and a vest and everything.
She looked good.
She still looked good. She still had
pretty
it, smoking. And she was playing it. And you know, the dumb guys and even a lesbian, you know, was falling for it and giving her money, ordering all the expensive stuff until she accidentally gets soup splashed all over her face.
Oh,
not just
no,
soup,
not soup
boiling
to the face.
Fucking hot soup straight to her face, burns her face, gives her first degree burns.
My cousin died because of a soup to the face accident.
Melted right away.
Right off.
Fell into that.
It was horrible.
Instantly dissolved.
And the worst part is,
with a thumbs up going slowly
down.
Nobody
noticed for like a week. And like people ate that stuff until somebody was like, hey, what's this femur doing here?
Okay.
Can I play another soundbite? It's probably one of the lines that I just, this whole scene, I just fucking laughed the whole entire time. Right. Watch it. It's after what's the waitress's name?
I'll just play a soundbite.
Well, yeah, don't worry about it.
Okay. Just play the
soundbite. There's only like two waitresses. Just do it.
Yeah, it's only Mia. It's after
Mia,
the ballerina gets her face boiled to death. She is forced to go wait on the champ because the champ got sat in her section.
Yeah, right, yeah.
So here we go. It's the champ first seeing Mia with the burnt face.
You're gonna love this waitress. She's a ballerina, graceful like a swan. Tell Mr. Yamamori.
Waitress wa desu shikeru.
Hey, champ.
What the fuck happened to you?
I got burned with soup.
Don't you know you're supposed to blow on it first?
Yes, champ.
Well, don't just stand there. Get out of here, soup face. You're offending my Tokyokin guests. Get me the smart girl.
Tara? Yeah, I'm gonna get her for you.
And tell her to bring me some champagne. I am so sorry, but her soup face scared the shit out of me. My voice is not that high.
That was classic.
Oh, I
right
fucking
there.
Love that scene.
for number two. Up, number two. There you go. Up, sweet release.
That's going to go everywhere. It's already going.
False alarm. There you go.
So, soup face.
Sounds like something a drill sergeant would say, like,
something that's like all sweaty and run for a mile.
Get out of here, soup face.
You're scaring my Tokyo and guests. I just love the part where it's like, I got burnt with soup. Don't you know you're supposed to blow on it first? Like things like that. It's just it's like his character doesn't think before he says shit.
He just like mispronounces a bunch of stuff. Just randomly threatens to break people's faces.
Oh yeah, there's one part in there. He's trying to pronounce the waiter's last names, and he keeps fucking up the one keeps fucking up guy's last
what was it,
last
meat
name
curtains or something.
Yeah, it's like meat
drapes.
Meat drapes. He kept calling it meat. Here, we'll just play it.
Who is guy meat drapes? What kind of name is that?
It's Madropides, sir. It's Greek.
Well, I think you're pronouncing it wrong. This says meat drapes.
It's actually pronounced Madropides.
Well, why doesn't it sound like that when I say it? Meat drapes.
I don't know.
You don't know much, do you, guy?
No, sir.
Meat drapes.
That's Madropides.
I'm going to name a kid a meat drapes.
Why does it sound like that when I say it? I love that. That's great.
Just like, I'm in charge. Fuck you.
Yeah, that soundbite actually brought up another part of the escalation of the plot where he's trying to get the 20, it's 20,000, he's trying to get $20,000.
Yeah,
one night to pay back the Yakuza because he went, should I just play that soundbite where he explains what the fuck?
Might as well. Okay. We're
just
halfway through my beer. We might as well play more, soundbites.
Do it.
But I do want to talk about something serious. Are you familiar with Japanese albino hunting?
Can't say that I am, no.
Oh, my God. It is all the rage in Japan right now. What they do is they set a bunch of Japanese albinos loose in the forest, and you hunt them.
And you shoot them?
No. It's just for sport. Strictly catch and release. So I bet the head of the Yakuza $20,000 that I could catch more albino than him. I mean, look at me. Come on, I'm an athlete. Well, you know what? I got my ass kicked. And now I got to pay him $20,000 by tomorrow.
Oh, sounds like somebody has to go to the ATM machine.
Yeah. You would think that, but I'm a little cash poor right now. I bought some land on the moon next to John Travolta.
Smart. Real estate's a very safe investment.
So here's what you gotta do for me. I need you to make $20,000 tonight, or else these guys are gonna come and take the restaurant.
Champ, the most the restaurant has ever made in one night is $15,000.
Oh, boo-hoo-hoo. I don't care.
I wish you would have told me I would have had more waiters on tonight.
I wish Nino Gutierrez would have told me he was going to sock me with a hard right in the fracas and caracas. And now look at him. He's dead.
I can see that.
So figure it out. If you don't get me 20 grand by tonight, I'm gonna lose the restaurant. If I lose the restaurant, I'm gonna be mad. And if I'm mad, I'm gonna beat the shit out of you and break all your arms.
Chip, I'm gonna need those arms. I got 3 kids.
All the more reason to keep it open. Okie dokie.
Okie dokie.
Albino hunting in Japan.
This is just gonna turn into just a bunch of quotes by Michael Clarke Duncan.
Oh, why not?
Just all the way through.
It's just a big homage.
I guess that works. I mean, he's got the best quotes in the whole movie.
Anyway, oh yeah, he does. Yeah, pretty much all of his quotes in this movie I remember. The rest of them I don't remember that much, except for Nuts, who has an alter ego Zongo whenever he doesn't take his medication. There's one scene where he just completely goes fucking crazy, and he's hallucinating that he's serving a table full of cats, and he does the line of, "How is everyone feline this evening?" I don't know. That always just stuck with me.
Well, that was when it went wrong. Like when he first went off his meds, due to daylight savings time, of course. He was actually quite
that
a success.
Was a big key throughout the whole thing, daylight savings.
Sort of a running gag.
I did like, how his depiction of a person with OCD.
Yeah.
It's really good. Now he's like counting to three. Sticking his thumb in every single dessert.
That's
pretty good. There's a scene where he's like sticking his thumb in every dessert. He's singing a song and gets to the end. He's like, and he doesn't finish the song. He's like, "But that's impossible. I haven't even touched this one."
Yeah, because Guy came up behind him when he wasn't looking and put his thumb right into one of the
Guy
the
really
dessert.
Was like the douchebag in like the entire film.
Oh, big time.
Like, yeah. He was that guy that, you know, always goes to the clubs, thinks that he know, you know, brags about all the people that he knows, this and that. And
he's the 45-year-old that goes to the, you know, discos or whatever.
He's bleaching his teeth, all that crap. His hair, you know, big poofy hair. The guy that kind of takes care of himself because he goes out of the clubs and is trying to get all these dirty slutty girls. Bangladeshi hooker.
And he banged her dish all night long.
That was from the movie.
That was.
Yeah.
Not something we did.
Well, I had sex with an orangutan.
Oh, you did?
Yep.
Bachelor party?
Yep.
What did it smell like?
Mostly bananas.
That was also from the movie.
Not something Nick did this week.
No, Guy, I did not have sex with an orangutan.
But I did.
The characters in this movie, like we've already said, they were funny. They were funny for that, for you know, just being there. But it was
their quirks.
There was little quirks in there, here and there. It was a little kind of a love triangle. Or not love triangle. no, it wasn't really a love triangle. It was, you know, there's a little like love interest here and there. You had twins.
It was like a past love sort of kind of.
Well, yeah, you had that, and then you also had Donnie and Tracy.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And the film itself, the script or the storyline, it had good parts to it. Probably wasn't the best that it could be. But
I don't know. Around, never gonna take.
It was definitely funny, but I think that there was parts in there that could have been flushed out a little bit better, or at least, you know, condense it more. And because there was parts where it just kind of felt like it was dragged on. Like there was so much going on at one time. Like you had so many little things going on, like different tables here and there. You had the one guy that's trying to propose to his girlfriend and, you know, sneak this, you know, custom made ring into a dessert.
But what happens?
Someone accidentally eats the dessert that it's snuck into. So now they have to wait for the ring to pass. So, you know, now he's sitting there having to listen to her. He's trying to, you know, kill time and this and that. And then you have, you have other people in there that are,
you have the guy talking to the hooker, and like all the waiters are like playing it up like he's been, you know, married for like 10 years or 20 years and you know, all this sort of stuff. And
really it's just a guy, you
just
know,
to get him to buy more crap for his table. And everybody stands up and applauds. And this guy's just like, "Yeah, I put it in her ass." I mean, look at her. Wouldn't you do that? And she's like, I'm not ashamed.
I'm just bored. Hey, I'm at the hotel room. I just want to put it in her ass. there's a lot of things going on here and there. That's why I think if it was a stage performance, it probably could have been done a little bit better, because you could focus on this table over here, and then on that table over here,
yeah,
that table over here a little bit better,
yep,
than throwing it into a film.
But then it would need musical numbers.
No, you don't need musical numbers. You always need musical numbers. You don't.
Come on.
You're thinking of musical theater, not just regular theater. We're talking about just regular theater.
I think it would need
musical numbers. This isn't Earth Girls Gone Easy, the stage show. This is
Earth Girls Gone Easy, the sequel or something. Yeah.
Was there a stage show?
Probably. Earth Girls Are Easy, not Earth Girls Gone Easy. Oh, they've gone easy somewhere.
But, fuck a baby.
But yeah, the script was kind of it was funny throughout the whole movie.
Oh yeah, yeah.
It definitely had its funny moments to it. The styling was really well, but as their most solid piece of work, I don't think this
not
was
at
it.
All. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, this also was. It had way less, I guess, marketing than any of their other works, too. I mean, this one just sort of floated it under the radar. I never even heard of this till last week anyway, so.
Yeah, same here.
Yeah, yeah. And the only reason why I heard of this is just because I kind of like, I'm always like, oh, what's Broken Lizard doing now? What are they going to do? What are they going to do?
What are they doing now?
They just came out with the movie Baby Makers.
Okay. Never heard of that one either.
Again, yeah. It's just right on right under the radar. I don't know if it's the full Broken Lizards or if Jay... Whatever the fuck his last name.
Jessica Rondebrick.
Yeah.
Dorishkikov.
That's what I said, motherfucker. he directed it. I don't know if it's like a full Broken Lizard story or whatever. I don't know if they wrote it. They wrote it and did all that, but
they're
it
all
is,
waiting table somewhere.
Right. It's on their website, and they are talking about maybe doing a sequel to. Super Troopers.
I think they've been talking about that for a while.
They've been talking about that since like 2007 or whatever. Yeah, so it's been in the talks for a while. I would like to see it. I would like to see.
I'd see Super Troopers.
Of all their movies, I think that's would should be the one they should go back to.
Yeah,
Because that's the one that really. I think that was probably the one that made them put them on the radar. Yeah, sort of put them on the map.
Yeah, because they had one film beforehand.
Did they?
Yeah, they had one film. It was like their first film as the Broken Lizard group, like their first film ever.
What was that?
Hi ho, hi ho, up the butt you go. Oh yeah, wait, no, that's some other.
It was a Puddle Cruiser.
Oh, okay. I was close. Yeah.
What was Puddle Cruiser about? Why aren't we watching that next week?
We can. There was actually a line in Puddle Cruiser, that's carried over into every single movie. It's like their own inside joke or their own. Easter egg. There's a line that's called "What's up, Soapy?" It was that line is in Puddle Cruiser, and it's in Super Troopers. It's in Club Dread. It's in Beer Fest.
It's in this movie.
It's in this movie. Like it's in all their movies. So I mean, that's kind of interesting. I thought that was kind of interesting. You know, that's their little like joke, and you know, their fans are like, "Hey, you
could." People who haven't watched their films are like, "I don't get it." People who watch more than like three of their movies are like, "Hey,"
but it's really fast. Like this, and Slammin
really
Salmon, you could hear it. You know that you said where he says it. Club Dread, it's very fast, very faint. You could barely hear it if you know where to look for it. Then you could pick it up. Same thing with Super Troopers. It's kind of in the background. It's when they open up the semi truck and they find all the soap and the weed and ever and everything. That's the line is said right there. So it's kind of you have to just try to find it. It's an Easter egg. Go find them.
Yeah, yeah. Go watch the movies.
Yeah, watch the movies.
I'm going to tell you where they're at. They're all there though.
Yep. Yeah. But so
Ben just threw up a little bit.
I just like burped and Chinese came up.
That was a burp.
So there was there's twins in this.
Yeah, there are.
Which that was kind of an interesting development in character, because the one twin it was
there was twins in Beer Fest.
Yeah, there were
twins in Beer Fest,
but it was funnier the way they did it.
Yeah. Oh, this one was kind of funny at times, and then not funny at times. It was kind of like
There wasn't a whole lot of laughs I got out of this, but I mean,
yeah,
it kept my attention the entire way through.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
This is the good thing about a movie like this is there's so much going on, and you know it's sort of convoluted. It's
for someone to grab onto,
and it goes pretty fast. It's not a movie where you're sort of like looking at your watch halfway through, going, what time is it? Jeez.
And it's definitely a movie.
Got things to see and people to do. Come on,
geez. It's definitely a movie where if you worked in the food industry, you're going to pick up a lot of stuff where you're like, yeah, you know, that reminds me of this or that reminds me of that. Like, I've never worked in the restaurant and business. Nick's never worked in the restaurant.
I have.
You've worked in the restaurant business. Was there anything in this movie that you could kind of like relate to just how some of the
I don't know.
Situations were?
This movie wasn't quite as relatable as like Waiting was. Waiting, you know, was very, very dead on, like common, you know, oh, that shit's happened to me at some point. This movie was more over, I think was way more over the top than Waiting was. So but the characters were just so far out there that not really. It was just more like fun.
What about like the whole people sending food back?
You know when I worked in the restaurant, that really didn't happen too often.
Really?
Yeah, like I've worked in fine dining and basically Mexican fast food. So
both well, ends of the scale. For Mexican fast food,
I mean,
you get what you get.
Yeah, fine dining was probably about the closest that I've ever had, I guess, to this movie.
It's either you're gonna get green diarrhea or brown diarrhea.
Yeah, right. Just dump a bunch of gravy on it, and we're good to go. I didn't have that much food sent back to me. Maybe like twice. Yeah. And you know, people are normally not dicks about it. They're just sort of like, hey, can you make this a little more well done? And you're like, oh yeah, sure, take it back there. You know, the cook just spits in it, puts some metal shavings on it, and fries it back up and sends.
Really?
It back.
Metal shavings?
With metal shavings? Oh, what? Did I say that? I'm really? Sorry.
Broken glass.
I meant
ground up in the mash.
Is this fucking Oz? Or
I meant au jus. You know, I'm metal shavings. What am I talking?
No, Melissa worked at a steakhouse for quite a while, and she would tell me about like people doing that where they would order a medium rare and it comes out medium rare. They're like, oh, this is pink in the center.
It's supposed to be
can you cook it a little bit longer? Which they had a situation in the movie that was kind of like that.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
The beginning of
no,
the
that ha- I mean, if you wait tables for any amount of time, something yeah, like that will happen. Yeah, most of the time, they aren't dicks like, you know, in this movie. They just ask you not.
Well,
like,
oh, sure. It was that like macho, like, yeah. Hey, you know, I'm dining here. I could afford this money or this spend the money here. So I'm going to be a dick to you because it's your job. He even says it right there at the beginning. They're monkeys. They're supposed to do whatever you tell them to do. And he like drops a fork on the ground. That's like, oh, let me pick that up for you, sir. Oh, let me do this for you, because they can't be dicks to you.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. If somebody's treating me like that, I'd be a dick to him. I'd be like, I'm not fucking waiting on you. Just leave.
Yeah. but that was also a call of the character.
Yeah.
Of,
it shows how that guy was
like,
just a major
pushover.
He was
such a pushover. And then
he got freaking burnt food shoved in his face, and he just let it happen.
Like, yeah, and he let it happen.
Any
he wasn't allowed to spit it out.
Would
and he
be
had
like,
to walk back to the
would
kitchen.
Would probably just, you know, throw that crap in the guy's face or, you know, punch him or something like
yeah.
that. Just walk out and leave.
Yeah, but he, you know, he's stuck with it. And then at the end of the movie, we finally see when Rich gives the money to Champ and says, well, you know, it's $19,017 or whatever. You know, we're just short of 20,000.
I'll take it out.
And
of
he's like, yeah, he's like, so okay, well, I'll just take the 19,000 and I'll take 1,000 out of people's tips. And Rich was like, oh, okay. And that's when, you know, this waiting staff is just like, what the fuck are you doing, dude? Stand up to him.
Finally grows some cojones.
Yeah, and he finally stands up to Champ, and which I thought was pretty cool. I'm played the soundbite for that here.
Champ. This money belongs to the waiters, and you owe Tara $10,000.
Whoa.
What the hell is wrong with you, Ricardo?
You offered a prize, and now you owe her.
You want to make something of it?
Yeah, I do. Just do what you promised, you motherfucker!
What?
Well, well, well. Look like somebody's little acorns done grew into big nuts. You're finally acting like a man. But you're too little too late. I still gotta pay the Yakuza 20,000 yen.
Wait, yen or dollars?
Same thing, stupid. Yen is Japanese for dollars.
Oh.
Actually, champ, 20,000 yen is about 170 American dollars.
So, in circumspeculation, that makes sense. When I was in the Orient, I used to wonder to myself, why is everything so small? yet so expensive. Good work, Dr. Doolittle. 170 for me, 10 grand for you. What do you think I should do with the rest of it?
I think you should give it to the waiters. I think they earned it.
Yeah, I guess so. I was wrong to think they could be replaced by robots.
Nice one, bitch.
Feed my pretties! Feed!
Whoa! Oh, my God! Oh, wait, what's that? Yen? Not so, dollars? Not? So, $20,000? Really?
20,000 yen?
So it's 20,000 yen! So they were pretty much set after the first fucking 30 minutes.
Yeah.
that sort of reminds me of one time I got a tip from this guy from India. He just gave me a 1,000 rupiah, I think it's rupiah bill. Yeah, I was all excited until I discovered that was worth like $1.50.
Oh, God.
Yeah. It would have cost me more money to convert it into American money than to actually just...
Yeah. Yeah, that you know that. So at the end, you know, he finds out. Oh shit! Okay, well, I can pay off the Yakuza. I could give the $10,000. What do I do with the rest of it? Instead of putting it back into the restaurant, he's just like, here you go, feed.
Yeah,
so, that would have been awesome though.
So right there, that shows that this guy that everyone was afraid of. If you just stand up to him, put your foot down and say, hey, this is, you need to do this. This is how you should do it. He's not going to kick the crap out of you. He's like, okay, yeah, you're right. Here you go. Oh, yeah. He's going to be nice. He's going to treat him right. And,
finally acting like a manager.
Yeah, that's finally acting. Yeah, there was, instead of acting like everyone's personal, circus performers, he had them, he was actually treating them like a manager should.
Right.
I mean, I don't know of any managers that have, thrown
dollar bills on
$9,000 in the air. It's like, here you go, take it.
Well, the average manager's salary is like $1 million a year, so I could see it,
Well, he's fucking he's goddamn like boxing champ. What is, didn't he say he was like undefeated and yada 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 all this?
Yeah, something like that. I don't know.
So in about 20 years, this is gonna be Floyd Mayweather.
No, in about 20 years, they're going to have a computerized simulation of him fighting Rocky.
Yeah. Wait, hold on.
Wait a minute, what?
Hasn't this already happened? What's going on here? Yeah, so, I mean, it had a good, character development for Rich.
Yeah, yeah.
And, I mean, the rest of them really didn't have a character development. I mean, they had a good character development for Donnie as well, because Donnie started off as the bus boy, and he's just like, "Hi, I'm here, I'm Donnie," getting shit faced because they're hazing him, and then boom, you have to be a waiter. He's like, "What the fuck? I have to wait tables." And he's the nice guy. He's not out to win the entire prize. He just doesn't want to be the low man on the totem pole, because if he is, he's gonna get a broken rib sandwich, and he doesn't want that. No one wants that. That's not a good sandwich to digest.
No, it's not. I mean, there's knuckle sandwich, broken rib sandwich, either one of those really sucks,
Yeah, knuckle sandwich, I could probably chew on that a little bit better than a broken rib sandwich.
But his luck is about to turn around.
Yeah, because towards the beginning of the movie, when the restaurant opens, there's one guy that comes into the restaurant. It's the first customer, and he sat down at a foretop, and Guy is given, it's in Guy's section. So Guy has to take care of this guy. And the only thing that this guy wants to do is read his book, which is War and Peace.
He starts at the beginning of
War and Peace. War and Peace.
600-page book.
And the only thing that he orders is a cup of hot water, and then he had, tea later on. He didn't order any food, really.
Yep.
And, Guy's getting all pissed off. He's the, because he's out for the prize. He's out for the money. He's like, once the restaurant starts getting really busy and you see that there's people waiting to be sat, and here's this guy that's taking up a foretop, and can be sat there. He gets pissed off, and the guy's like, fuck it, I'm just gonna give the table to Donnie, because this is a wash, nothing's gonna happen from this. The guy stays there all the way until closing, and Donnie finally comes up, gives him the bill after the guy finishes
War and Peace,
the book War and Peace. They have this nice little, little dialogue, which kind of brought you out of the whole comedy feel. Yep, you're just like, whoa, shit.
You're like, what's this?
feelings in my comedy movie.
So here, let me play the soundbite here for you.
I'm sorry, sir. I think you made a mistake. I can't take that much money.
I didn't make a mistake. What's your name?
Donald Kenogi.
I'm dying, Donald Kenogi. My doctor told me that I have a month to live. Have you ever heard of schistosomiasis?
No, I haven't.
Well, I've got it. I've got it hard.
Oh, my God.
All I wanted to do tonight was to sit quietly, have a nice meal, read a little Russian pre-existentialism. It was pretty crowded, but unlike the other waiter, you were content to let me sit here nonetheless. And I thank you for that.
But, sir...
No, young man, you can't take it with you. Now, if you'll excuse me, I got a lot of living to do before I die. Does Fidanya.
So he's dying.
That
of
sucks.
Some fucked up disease.
A scurvirosiasis.
Sure.
I don't know why. I think that might have been the funnest part of the movie for me.
Because it's like it's trying to be serious, but still it's throwing comedy at you.
So. It's like Will Forte doing it. It's like, come on.
No, I can't take it.
I'm dying. I have a month to live.
You can't take it with you.
Yeah.
I'm going to go now. See you later. I have a lot of living to do.
And then he gets run over by a fucking horse. Which is so random because that's what I wonder. I'm like, I wonder if they wrote the script and they got to that part. And they're like, what happens? I don't know. Let's have a car drive through and hit him. Oh, that's so cliche. And plus, there's like a dining area out there. What about a horse?
Where the fuck are we going to get a horse?
Why are we going to have a horse? I don't know. Why don't we have Champ come into the restaurant with a horse earlier on? All right. Why not?
It worked. That horse was flying, too.
Yeah.
He's like, never seen a horse go that fast.
Yeah. That was a Cadillac horse.
Yeah, evidently. Had a lot of horse power.
Wow.
So
I had to get the stupid joke in there somehow.
So at the end of the movie, okay, so when they're telling who the winner of the contest is, you would think, you know, Donnie getting a $1,000 tip would be the winner. Well, earlier on in the movie, when he, you know, when Tara sees that he's, you know, all depressed, and he's like, I'm about to get fucking knocked the fuck out by the champ. God damn.
I just threw up a little bit more.
I keep throwing up in my mouth a little bit.
At least you're aiming away from the mic, man. At least you're aiming away from Mike.
She gives him one of his tables. She's like, well, here, I have, you know, I have Nutella or whatever the fuck this artist is, one of the, you know, a singer. I have her table, and it's over $1,000. Her check is going to be over $1,000, so I'll be good. You take one of my other tables. So he took that and said, okay, well, she helped me out. I'm going to help her out. And he gives Tara the $1,000 check, or the $1,000 tip, saying that that was her table, which makes her the winner for the $10,000. But did her one table from Nutella, how much money did she get out of that, Scott?
She got $1,000.
No.
She got $5.
No.
She got $22.
No.
She got $10,000.
No.
She got $16,000.
No.
I don't know. I wasn't listening.
And the alcohol finally hit Scott.
Yep, pretty much.
Since she's an artist, and you know one of the big famous people there, she's another person that kind of walks all over people. Which Champ comps her meal, and since it's zero, what's 20% of zero? Zero.
Zero.
So
that's called being a bitch.
Yeah. So this woman has her whole entire entourage. They spend over $1,000 at the table, and they pay nothing for it, not even a tip. So Tara's screwed. So even though she was kind, gave up her table, she got nothing out of that. She would have lost.
Yep.
But Donnie, being the kind-hearted guy that he was, gave her all of his money from that one guy who got ran over by the poor horse.
Yep.
Yeah. So, you know, that's an interesting character development for him. Because he's like, you know, he started off as this, well, I'm going there now. I'm just the buff boy, and I'm getting all drunk to, I'll save you. I don't know where the fuck that was going.
You were on the right track, but you got derailed by Apple.
Yeah, he was the hero. What other characters? What other characters? The once TV star, now back to...
We didn't even talk about him.
Yeah, we didn't talk about him. We should talk about him.
He knows.
Yeah, he was a waiter that worked at the restaurant. That, you know, he's one of those starving artists who works at a restaurant, tries to make it in television or film. And he gets a role on CFI.
CFI
Hotlanta.
Hotlanta.
Yeah, yep.
Which, it's just...
You're just like, oh, God.
You know exactly really? What it's making fun of CSI.
Yep.
But it's CFI Hotlanta. And his
CSI, character, the shittiest show that never dies.
That's kind of right.
They will continue to
make. They got rid of CSI Miami.
Oh, they did?
They got rid of it. Wow.
I thought that show was going to go on like billions of seasons.
Nope. They got rid of David Caruso.
Man. Shut up, damn. The Who.
Yeah. So he got, after two episodes of CFI Hotlanta, he gets killed off, and he makes up this big huge story that, you know, oh, I had this this fling with Morgan Fairchild, and
in the back of the bus,
yeah, and that's why I got shit canned and yada yada yada. And then later on in the film, the whole cast of CFI Hotlanta is in the restaurant, including Morgan Fairchild and the producer, and you find out later on that the reason why he got fired was because he was hired on as like the detective with this big schnoz. I mean, originally he has a big schnoz.
Yep.
And they keep, you know, harassing him, saying, "Oh, you got a nose job. You got a nose job." He's like, "No, I didn't get a nose job.
I had my haircut. No, it makes your nose
I just got smaller. A haircut. The camera adds, you know, 2 pounds to the nose." But you find out that he got a nose job because obviously he's, you know, he's insecure about his nose, and that was the reason. You know, that was the whole reason why he had that part.
Because they were going to feed off of his big nose. And
yeah, you know, it's like, oh, I smell trouble, or yeah. I got, you know, a nose for this, or, you know, yada, yada, yada. And then he gets a fucking nose job. And we're like, well, we can't do that. You can't do that. So we need to get rid of you.
The director was like, you know what it's like to rewrite an entire season in a week?
Yeah, yeah. So they got rid of him and hired on, you know, someone else. So now he's back doing this, you know, waiting tables and everything, which is kind of, I guess, like that could be a, you know, a big like hit to the that gut right sucks, there. You're like, oh, fuck, because of the way that he left. He's like, fuck you, eat a dick. He's like, fuck all of you.
Why would they hire him back? So
good. Yeah, and then he comes back. He's like, oh, I'm back. Yeah,
sorry, I shoved coleslaw down my pants and kicked it on the door.
It's like, I blew all my money, and then I get shit canned, and hi. So, you know, so the whole time he's like, he has customers that are like, hey, don't I know you from somewhere? He's like, yeah, from TV maybe?
No,
like, you waited on me last time. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, okay.
So that was an interesting character. But any development with that? Nope.
Nope.
I mean, there was the development of you found out the real reason why he lost his job. It wasn't because of a fling with Morgan Fairchild. He didn't even have that. It was just... He was insecure about his looks, and he got a nose job, but his looks are what got him the job, and now that he doesn't have that feature anymore...
They don't want him, so...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like Christopher Reeves becoming paralyzed. He can't be Superman anymore.
No.
He can be quadriplegic
Superman. Yeah, he can be like, up, up, and away!
That's pretty bad. We both thought of that joke at the same time.
Hey-o.
Yeah. That's pretty wrong.
That's extremely wrong.
It's okay to make fun of him because he's been dead long enough. Give it at least a year, then we'll start making fun of Michael Clarke Duncan.
Oh, boy.
I did like the one they threw in the line of at the end where Michael Clarke Duncan's talking about how he was afraid of the dark, which is kind of a callback to the Green Mile.
That's
nice. Kind of clever. That was kind of clever.
I don't even need to sleep with a light bulb anymore.
So they had little character developments here and there, but they were very small. They really weren't like, you know...
Best ending credit song of all time.
There was only two... There was one major character development, one minor character development, and then the rest of them were just kind of there. There wasn't any real reason. Guy really didn't have any character development, except he got what, you know, was coming to him at the end because he was a dick.
Right.
Maya didn't have any character development, except, you know, like... She was playing off of her looks, and then she got burnt.
Well, most of the characters are there just for hijinks' sake.
Yeah, they were just there for hijinks' sake. But I mean, I kind of wanted to see more out of this stuff. I wanted to see more out of an ensemble.
A little more complex.
Yeah, a little bit more complex. Maybe. Like at least in Beer Fest, there was character development throughout the whole entire ensemble. Same thing with Super Troopers. Club Dread was just a slasher comedy film. There was not really that much character development that you could have. But I wanted to see a little bit more out of the character development in this film because you could have totally done it.
Right.
They set him up to do it, and then it just kind of whittles away, and nothing comes up from it.
Yeah, so I was actually pretty satisfied with the character development. They kept the focus more on the more important characters, I thought. But
yeah, Rich was the main character, I would think, and his character development was good. I mean, they followed that through all the way, but it just kind of seems like the others, they were there, and then they're gone, and then they're back, and then there wasn't a lot. Like, you could have gotten rid of some of those characters and it would have been fine.
Oh, yeah.
So.
Yeah.
But then you wouldn't have enough white staff.
True.
Well, like you could have combined some of the characters. Like, Guy's character could have been combined with whatever the fuck the other guy's name. The one that went off and was on the TV show.
You know? This was almost like, they just had too many, people in their comedy troupe. They didn't want to cut people's roles or anything.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah.
Up with stuff.
Or instead of making Donnie the a twin, you could have just had that. You could have just had him play Donnie instead of Donnie and the chef. Yeah. Even though you had the shtick at the end where his brother's a real dick. No one likes his brother, and he's the brother's making out with Tara at the end, and she thinks that that's Donnie, and then you find out that it's not. That's like the only good gag for twin action right there that you had.
Yeah.
But
that's pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, I have my problems with it, but overall, I mean, I could look past it and like it's still a good movie. It's entertaining. I like it.
I laughed. I cried. I saw people get run over by a horse. That's all that really matters. So,
yeah. Yes.
Michael Clarke Duncan threatened to put people's things up people's asses, and that was pretty much it. And, it's all good. So, what more do you want out of a movie? That's what I ask you. What more do you want?
All right, I'm going to play two more of my favorite Michael Clarke Duncan sound bites from this movie, and then we'll go into final
reviews. Okay,
all right. So here we go. Here's the
number
Number one.
Hey, get a carrot for the SS Fudgelicious, okay?
I assume that's the horse.
Never assume. When you assume, you make an asshole out of yourself.
Okay, so that's the first one.
That's the first one.
That's a good one.
Yep, all right, and here is the second one.
Number two.
You have to dominate the swordfish. Only then can you saute it.
Thanks, champ.
And there's the second one.
Also very true.
Man. Yes. God. He will be missed.
So close.
So much. All right. So, Scott, we'll go with you for your final review.
All right. Well, I mean, I like this movie. This movie is great. You may complain a little bit about, character development and all that stuff. I actually thought it was fine. It kept the focus on, the good characters. It was funny. It had everything you expect out of, one of the Broken Lizard movies. They had, hijinks out the wazoo, over-the-top characters. We got that there.
Very quotable lines.
Very quotable. And once again, people threatening to put stuff up people's asses. I really enjoyed it. I'll keep this short. I'll say, if you're a fan of sort of like slapstick random comedy, this is a must-have. This is a buy. If you're just like, if you just like comedy in general, I'd say this is a watch. But overall, I'll give this my seal of approval for comedy. I will say buy this shit. You may not have heard of it, but it's good.
No, buy.
Yep.
I think that's one of the first buys we've had.
Let's
for
go
a while.
Over
for this,
to Nick.
For this season. I am not going to agree with Scott on this one.
Because you're a douche.
I thought it was good. I would say watch it. It'd be hard to recommend a buy, even if you are like a huge fan of Broken Lizard on this one. It was fun. It kind of sped along, but there just wasn't enough there to make me go like, oh, I got to rush out and buy this thing. Strangely enough, though, kind of like you said, Ben, if this was a stage play, I would say go see it. Because I think it would be a great stage play. But beyond that, no, just not enough for a buy. I'm going to give it a solid, maybe not even a solid watch. I'd say check it out,
Okay. You'll give it the C plus of watches.
I'll give it a C plus, maybe.
Of watches,
Maybe just a solid C.
All right. Well, I don't agree with Nick. I do agree with Scott.
Yes.
But I don't agree with Scott, and
damn
I do
it.
Agree with Nick.
Yay!
I'm
confused.
If this is a stage, if this was a stage
opinions
play,
opinions is like assholes.
Yeah.
Everybody's got them, but everybody denies they have them.
Don't want to admit.
No.
Oh God! Whoa. Damn it! All right,
Ben threw up a little bit again. Jesus, like
it's
the third
on the
time.
Mic.
Man, it's like chunks everywhere.
I would, if this was a stage play, definitely. Yeah, I would definitely say go see it. It's totally worth the money to go see, even if you have to fly to a different state to go see it. Go see it. Go fucking see it. It's definitely worth it. As a DVD or a Blu-ray, me personally, I want to buy it. I don't have it in my collection right now, and the reason is it is fucking hard to find. I have checked Best Buy, I've checked all, you know, Walmart, Target. I've even checked MovieStop. They don't have it. It is a hard movie to buy. You could find it on Amazon, or you could have them order it, but that's probably,
you have to go on
no.
That's the only way that you're going to be able to get it right now is to just, you have to order it. Because you can't just go into a store and buy it, and that's where I say, watch it, because...
So, let me ask this. Are you saying you want to buy it just because it's hard to find?
No.
Okay.
No, I'm saying that I would say go and buy it, but since it's so hard to find, I don't know if you would want to go through all the effort to, you know, yeah, ordering it, having it shipped, this and that.
You just go through Amazon, you're like, oh, there it is, click.
Well, yeah, but like...
I wouldn't sell that, you know, it's not like, oh, you have to go on a vision quest and find a bunch
of... I'm not saying
you go
on a fucking vision quest, I'm just saying like go and like, you know, okay, find it online,
and then meditate
like,
for 2 years.
Buy it. Ship it, because you know some people are fine with doing it. I'd rather go to the store and pick it up, because if I'm wanting to buy something, I'm either wanting to watch it now or, you know, have it right now. Buying it online, it's either if it's something I really really fucking want and it's hard to find, or it's just cheaper online. With this movie, I'm probably going to end up just ordering it or buying it online, because I would like to have it. I'm slowly wanting to build. I have Super Troopers, and I did have Beer Fest for a little bit, but I don't have it anymore. But I want to get them on Blu-ray, just because, you know, I think the special features would be kind of interesting. Plus, a lot of their movies, they have like a drinking game to go with it.
Yeah,
so that would be
well.
Fun.
That's good.
That would be fun.
I do have one DVD that actually has a drinking game built into it. It's called Wild Zero, which we're probably not going to review on here, considering that it's the only way to watch is Japanese with English subtitles. So sort of kill the sound bites.
Here's this sound bite. What's going on?
Oh, yes,
Toyota. That was racist. I'm sorry.
That was pretty racist.
Yeah. But yeah, man. So I would say definitely go buy it if you're willing to go and just order it online and not go to a store and get it.
They might have it like a MovieStop, maybe.
I've checked every single MovieStop all the way to Orlando. They don't have it.
Damn.
They don't have it.
Cray.
Yeah. But every single one said we could order it for you. I'm like,
I need to do that myself.
I'll just do it myself. Yeah. I don't want to go get it on Amazon. Damn it. So yeah, definitely buy it, but you'll have to buy it most likely online.
Probably, yeah.
So yeah,
low publicity film, I'd say.
Well, all of their movies are done with a low budget, because you know, they're not, you know, they don't go through any of the mainstream production houses. So it's all like low budget stuff. It's once they get the funding to do it, they'll do a movie. That's why you don't see a lot of movies being pumped out from Broken Lizard.
Yeah, like once every couple of years, maybe.
Yeah. But all right, so next week it is...
I think it's my turn.
No, because you just brought in Earth... No. Yeah, you did Earth Girls Are Easy, Jason X,
meh.
So yeah, it's your turn.
Yeah, so it's getting to that time of the year again where I start whipping out the holiday films. Wonder what holiday is next. Nick, what holiday is next?
Rosh Hashanah?
St. Patrick's Day?
Guys are killing me.
Box Day?
Box Day?
Boxing
Day?
Well,
I do like
Boxing Day.
I do like Boxing Day. So boxy. But no, it's coming up on Halloween real quick here. I mean, like, it's here. It's virtually here.
Halloween.
I got it. Ben's good.
I got it.
He's good. It's practically like I said it out loud. I didn't think I said it out loud, but
pretty good. I should go on Jeopardy.
Pretty good.
Yep. So anyway,
Jeopardy's still around.
Doc's Breck without a mustache. I don't think it's real Jeopardy anymore. But anyway, I was talking to Nick outside earlier, and I was like, man, I need a Halloween movie. And he's like, well, how about Halloween? So I was like, all right, okay. It's like, that sounds great. There was a really shitty Halloween movie. And so my next pick here is going to be Halloween 3.
Wait, I just love the way that he said that. You went all like Southern twang. Halloween.
Yeah. We're going to watch Halloween twang. You know, Deep South rubs off on me sometimes. But anyway, yeah, so I'm going to pick Halloween 3.
Tampa is not the Deep South.
This is about as Deep South as you can get. No. It's so Deep South, we can't even find it anymore. It's so Deep South, people don't even speak in a Southern accent down here anymore. It's like you've gone past the epicenter of redneck culture and Tampa. That's where I end up. I'm sorry. It's super Deep South. It's like turbo Deep South. It's like...
Okay.
But anyway, yeah. So, yeah. All right. I'm going to go and pick Halloween 3. I think the subtitle of that is like Secret of the Witch or something like that. I can't remember.
Like, that's the one where the kids are possessed by the masks, right?
Yep. It's the one where there is... basically no...
There's no Michael Myers.
No Michael Myers. It's pretty shitty. So I think we're going to watch that one.
So it's a Halloween movie without...
It's Halloween movie minus Halloween. So okay.
All right. That should be interesting.
Yep.
So why did you pick that one and not like... It's Season of the Witch.
Season of the Witch. All right, I knew it was something of the Witch.
Season
of...
Oh, it came out in 82.
Oh, shit. Yeah. That's
good stuff. So why did you pick that one and not like... Because a lot of people have said that the newer Rob Zombie Halloween movies are just complete shit.
Really?
Which I disagree with. I like them. I thought they were well done.
Because I felt like subjecting you to an abject horror of Halloween without Michael Myers.
So this is going to be the second horror franchise sequel that we've watched.
Yep.
Okay, but this will be the first horror franchise sequel that we've watched that doesn't have the...
Super Shredder.
Yeah, well, it doesn't have the trademark killer.
Right, yep.
Okay.
It's the classic movie mistake where they release a movie that's with a franchise but don't include the popular character that, you know, caused the franchise to take off.
That would be like Michael Bay wanting to do a fourth Transformer movie and not have Optimus Prime in it.
Right.
Oh, wait!
It's like Prometheus.
But Prometheus was called... No, it's not like Prometheus. If it was like called Alien the Beginning and didn't have any aliens, then yeah. But it's Prometheus. and Ridley Scott even said, it's not an alien movie, but it was.
It was. So, Halloween 3, Season of the Witch.
Season of the Witch.
There's so much Halloween in there. It's natural.
Yeah. Halloween 3, Season of the Witch, or also known as Halloween 3, Mike Myers Takes a Nap.
Instead of drinking beer, can we just eat a lot of candy during that one?
Just a bunch of candy corn?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Candy corn is like 90% wax, man. I don't know if I...
And toenails. Candy corn, here to here. A little bit of sugar. 95% wax.
5% toenails.
5% toenails.
Candy corn is like Twinkies. I mean, it'll last for years.
It'll just sort of form into a giant waxy lump.
It'll never be able to penetrate. Candy corn is so nasty. That's like you eat it and you're like, oh. Yeah. Ugh. And then the next year comes around and you just eat it again. You're like, why do I keep doing this? Because it's just here.
Oh man, yeah.
All right, so next week
we're gonna review the candy corn of Halloween movies.
Yeah. It really is the candy corn of Halloween movies. Fuck, that is the best analogy.
You don't
for
really
Halloween.
Know if you want it, but there's just so much of it. You just
got it because you're like, well, fuck, it's mixed in with the rest of the candy. I guess I have to eat it. You know, I don't want to throw it away and not deal with it. I'll just eat it. There's only a couple pieces here.
And a couple turns into 10. And then before long, you've eaten a whole bag and you're like, oh, God.
Fuck, so much candy corn.
Now I got to buy more. Shit.
All right. So, next week, Halloween 3.
The re-Halloween.
The search for Mike Myers.
Wow.
Oh man,
so stupid.
That was really stupid. I'm gonna take on that one. Michael Myers Begins.
He's just kind of there going, you know what, no, I'm sitting this one out. I don't feel like killing this week.
I lost my mask. You guys take over.
So you know, I'm let's just, you know, child labor laws. Yeah. Fuck them. Let's have some kids do my job.
1982. What do they care? So.
Yeah.
Better right. be working in the coal mines.
Woo! All right. It's time to go to the bar now. Yes, let's yes. do it. So, yeah, so make sure to check out next week's episode. Where
Or we watch a movie.
Where we watch a movie. We
watch Halloween 3.
Nothing more different.
Stupid shit happens.
Yeah. And for Halloween 3, Season of the Witch, we'll have three different people here. We just won't fucking review it.
We're all wearing masks and the entire podcast is like...
What?
Alright. So, till next week, I'm Ben.
I'm your chocolatey voiced host with the most. God,
I you lost it.
Yep.
Never do that.
I'll drink an entire beer.
Never do that. You know what's really great? The fact that you just said, I drank an entire beer and I feel sloshed. And at home, people were like,
it's got so much alcohol in it.
I know. No one could really see the size beer. No one could see the size of the bottle.
It's a 32-ounce beer with 10.5 freaking percent alcohol. So, yeah, all right. If I can't do Morgan Freeman right now,
it's a goddamn wine bottle. That's pretty much what it is.
And Nick, who are you?
I'm Michael Clarke Duncan.
God. All right, and this has been the Movie Dump Podcast. Enjoy your week.
I'm tired, boss. Tired of being on the road, lonely as a sparrow in the rain. I'm tired of never having me a buddy to be with, to tell me where we's going to, coming from, or why. Mostly I'm tired of people being ugly to each other. I'm tired of all the pain I feel and hear in the world every day. There's too much of it. It's like pieces of glass in my head all the time. Can you understand?
Yes, John, I think I can.